International. I'm Fikisha Kumbo, and we're at Tatoo with the lovely RHONDA ROSS, who's about to become a major starlet on the scene in the world. Hi, RHONDA.
Hi, Fikisha.
How you doing?
Good, thank you.
Good. We're going to be watching you sing tonight.
Yeah.
Can't wait. You know, having been born when your mother was already rich and famous, how did that impact on your childhood?
I don't know anything else, first of all. So, I mean, I got used to it very quickly, but I think you also get used to kind of sharing her with the public and with her work and with her career. And it becomes very okay, you know, and so it was good. It was good.
What, did you relate to her family? I mean, her mother?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I was very close with, I'm very close with her family. My sisters and myself are very close with her sisters and brothers and her mother who has now passed away, but, you know, and our grandfather on that side. Yeah.
What about your schooling? What type of schooling did you, I know it had to be private school.
It was. I was lucky. I went to school in Switzerland for a couple years. That was good to kind of see outside of America and see what that was about. Learn French and that sort of thing.
Do you speak French?
I do.
Oh. Okay, now how about vacations? What kind of vacations did you go on? Where'd you go?
We went skiing, you know, those kind of vacations out to the beach and that sort of thing. My mom, we like to stay at home a lot. We have a lot of like Christmases, well, Thanksgiving's always at home, you know, so.
Did you and your sisters sing when you were growing up?
We did. I mean, I don't think any of us wanted to sing professionally. I only decided recently to sing professionally, but we sang often and we did shows for the family often. Under the leadership of my aunt, my Aunt Rita, my mother's younger sister, and she would like choreograph these dances for us, and we really would do three girl dances.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
So you had a little group, right?
Yeah, we did. And in our house in California, we had this little kind of stage in the room that we would play in, you know, and so we did shows for the family, and they had to watch it. It was really.
What made you decide to start singing?
Professionally.
Yeah.
I don't know exactly. I was singing when I was in school, and I was singing, you know, at little clubs around Providence and that sort of thing. And again, I still didn't think I was going to do it as a living until I graduated. And I think it's because I came here and asked for a gig here, and they said they wanted me regularly here at Tatoo. And that's when I decided, well, maybe I can do this. You know?
Did you get a lot of encouragement from your family?
Yeah. I've gotten encouragement in everything that I've done. Yeah. I mean, from athletics to academics to singing, everything.
What's been your mother's input into your career?
Well, you know, she's always let me kind of do things on my own. And I like doing things on my own. But then recently, I've been a little bit overwhelmed. And actually, we just had a talk about a week ago, and I finally said, I don't know what I'm doing. Can someone help me? I don't know what I'm doing. And so then she started kind of really saying, okay, look, this is what I think you should do. And, you know, and it was, okay. She didn't really know I needed that help, or she didn't know I wanted it. You know,
in which way did you feel, like, overwhelmed?
Well, you know, I don't know. It's also new to me, everything, between whether I should get a manager, an agent, how to start looking for a record deal, how to look for other gigs, you know, how to really get your own craft and get your style together, how to relate to an audience. All of it is so new for me, you know, and it's also so old for her. It's kind of like so old hat that, you know, she doesn't think to really give me advice about that thing sometimes. And then, you know, sometimes I have to kind of remind her that I'm so kind of confused, you know.
So when did you start?
Professionally?
Yeah.
About 4 or 5 months ago.
So you really just started. So we're getting you really, really
yeah,
early.
Yeah, I just started.
Oh, that's fantastic. Yeah. You know, you finished Brown University with honors.
I did.
In African American Studies.
Yeah.
Why did you decide to do African American Studies, and how has that impacted on you?
Well, Brown, first of all, it's not really a vocational school. You can't really leave there with a degree that will get you a job like that. It doesn't have hotel management or those kind of very practical job majors. So I decided to study something that I loved, something that really would mean a lot to me, something that would influence my life. Mm-hmm. It might not get me a job directly out of school, but it would influence who I was and whatever career I went into. And I had a great teacher who unfortunately passed away, but a great teacher named George Bass. And I remember, I think I was a theater major or a film major, and he said, no, you need to study your own people. You need to know what you're talking about. And I saw it. And it was great. Yeah. And I mainly focused in black literature. You know,
okay.
So, yeah, it was an incredible major.
So how has it impacted upon your life?
Well, I think I have more of a pride in myself, in my culture. I'm definitely more knowledgeable, mm-hmm. which gives me a certain self-confidence, which is important. Mm-hmm. And I realize there's so many things I'm interested in, whether it be jazz, or whether it be film, or whether it be literature. It always has a focus in blackness. Mm-hmm. That's important to me. Yeah.
I understand there was a lot of like political stuff going on in Brown.
Yeah, yeah.
And first of all, how did it impact upon you as a woman?
Mm-hmm.
And secondly, as an African-American person?
Well, I've always been really vocal about my opinions about being female, about being black, very much so. And in high school, it was really looked down upon. It wasn't exactly desirable. And when I got to Brown, it was great because so many people were so vocal, you know. And it was okay to feel a pride in who you were as an individual. And there were black theater groups and female, you know, groups and that sort of thing. And it was an incredible thing. And so I was part of the black theater there, and we organized the Black Arts Network, and I directed, you know, black written plays, black casted plays, and it was fantastic.
Where'd you go to high school?
I went to Riverdale Country School. It's up in the Bronx.
Oh, okay. Are you studying acting?
No, I'm not. I have all my life up until now, actually.
Okay.
Yeah, I have. I've been taking acting classes since I can remember.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. How about voice?
I want to. I'm taking great class now. It's not so much in my voice or my breathing, but it's in jazz improvisation. And she's like teaching me how to improvise. And she's teaching me the scales and the chords, because I know nothing about that. I've never studied music. And she's teaching me on the piano, so I get to learn how to play, which is important to me. And she's teaching me how to improvise and how to really find what's true for me, you know. And
who's your teacher?
The woman named Alex Damien. Okay. And she just, you know, she's just a woman, and she's was an actress herself, and she was an improviser, and she's a singer. And I go to her house once a week, and we play the piano. It's incredible.
Well, you know, the reason I ask you about your acting, because you're about to star in this short on Bessie Coleman. Tell me about that.
It's incredible. I mean, Bessie Coleman, as far as I understand, was the first black and first female pilot, American pilot, before Amelia Earhart. And no one talks about her. And she's only got one biography out on her. No, nobody knows this woman.
I meant to tell you not to mention dates so we can run this forever.
Oh, okay. Did I already mention something?
No, but I meant to tell you before and I think
I won't. Okay. But she's an incredible woman. And she wanted to learn how to fly, and the only people flying in America were white men, and nobody would teach her. And so she had to go to France and fly with the women there. And she's incredible.
So you got the script at home, and your mom also got it? What's the situation with that?
Well, I met with Leslie Harris.
Okay.
And I had met her just because
I'm the producer.
Who's the director?
Director, okay.
And the writer. Uh-huh. And I met her just because I'm interested in film, and I was looking for a job. I gave her my resume and that sort of thing. And on my resume mentions I act. So she called me about 2 weeks later, and she said, do you want to audition? And I did. And when I found out what it was about, I realized I had the biography in my home because my mother had it in her bookshelf. So I read it, and then I told my mother about the part. She said, wait. Someone sent me that book because I was supposed to do that part. She's like, what are you doing? Are you taking my parts? So it was good. You know, we're in competition for parts now, my mom. Not quite.
That's cute.
Yeah.
Well, you know, everybody knows now that you're the biological daughter of Barry Gordy.
Yeah.
Have you always known that he was your biological father?
No, I knew at 13.
Oh, you did know at 13?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. And how has that impacted upon your life with having a superstar mother and a super mogul music man as a father?
Well, you know, it's interesting because I've been thinking about this a lot. I've always seen it as, you know, like I have a lot of respect for my mother, and yet I see her as a human person. And so I've always thought of it as if she could do that, then I could do it, you know? And I never was that intimidated by it. And I guess I thought the same about my father. I didn't think about it as much, but I did think about it with my mother. And it's only recently that so many people are coming up to me and saying, wait, aren't you terrified, and you'll never be able to be like her, and you'll never be able to make it this big. And all of a sudden I'm like, God, you're right. Oh my God. You know, it's only recently. And I actually said that to someone about 3 days ago, and they said to me, Rhonda, you know, don't let someone else tell you how you should be feeling about something. If it's not intimidating you, then it's not intimidating you, and that's it. And it really hasn't. I mean, I've seen it as like a nice kind of push in a good direction, you know. I mean, I've really always thought that if I know how hard my mother works, you know, I know it, and if she could put the time in and the energy and the focus, then so could I.